Greetings. I've mentioned before something I call a false choice, and many examples occur without us thinking about them. You are presented with two options and only two. Basically, someone says, either you are blank or you are blank. But if you think carefully about both choices, they do not constitute every possible option. In school, you may have seen a Venn diagram. You have a box that represents all possible choices. This is the universe. And then you represent choice A with a circle, and then you represent choice B as a different circle. They may or may not intersect. And then the area of the universe, which is not in choice A and not in choice B, are your other choices. The rest of the universe. Here's an example. Either you are a teetotaler, notice the blue circle that says only tea, or you are an alcoholic, notice the red circle with alcohol. But there's this world in between of drinking coffee, Coke, soda, and a little wine, like Paul says. Either you believe some dogma, or you are not Christian. And that ignores this whole part of the universe. You're a Christian, but disagree with the dogma. And in this video, I'd like to start a series about the following false choice. Either you believe in evolution, and by that I mean godless evolution, or you are a young earther. I think there is a very plausible third option between these two. If you look for something called the gap theory, you will find mentions of it. But I've never found one with enough detail for my satisfaction. Meaning, I'd like to see it more fully defined. Not that I am unsatisfied with the theory. So I am going to lay out some things to think about that differ from pure godless evolution. But also, will not dogmatically adhere to the young earth proposition. I call this video series The Legos of God. And I'll bet some of you thought he's misspelled logos. No, I really mean Legos. As in little building blocks. The little building blocks God used to make creation. To make space-time. I'm about to make a statement I cannot prove. But I still think it needs to be said and pondered, because I do not think it can be disproven. But don't accept it without question, and don't reject it summarily either. Ponder it. Consider it. Mull it over. Here you go. God created space-time for no other reason than as an incubator for human spirits. Yep, Texas has been kicked in the head by a mule. No, seriously, give this idea a moment to percolate. God created space-time for no other reason than as an incubator for human spirits. Think about what an incubator is and does. An enclosed apparatus providing a controlled environment for the care and protection of premature or unusually small babies. An enclosed apparatus. Space-time is a closed system to us. Our senses can, may, perceive nothing outside of it, providing a controlled environment. Space-time appears to be ruled by a set of laws, controlled, for the care and protection. Maybe that is harder to see. The universe seems harsh and unforgiving, but we don't know what we don't know. Meaning we don't know what God is protecting us from or how bad it could be. I recognize this is a subjective assertion. It can be argued, but please go along for now. Of premature or unusually small babies. The Bible reveals God is a spirit. As such, his native environment is the spirit realm. If God were to create babies, I submit they would be baby spirits. If he were to create them in his image, or after his kind, imagine God creating a created being as close as he can to himself. And for the moment, allow this leap in my thesis as well. Please hear me out and see if this does bring an aha moment. God created space-time for no other reason than as an incubator for human spirits. God created space-time. All religions or worldviews of any worth try to answer questions. And the Judeo-Christian worldview is that Yahweh created all things. That answers the who, but not the why. Well, let me ask another question to guide our discussion. What happens to this universe in the end? If you believe in A, the cosmological fate, that the stars cool in a trillion years, then ultimately it spreads into nothingness. I'm tempted to call this functional destruction, because there is no discernible difference between that and destruction. Or B, you can believe the Bible's hints of the replacement by a new heaven and a new earth, which means the old heavens and old earth have been destroyed. I get the feeling that means space-time will be gone. That is not meant as a false choice between the cosmological and the biblical descriptions of how it ends. I'm sure that there are other worldviews of an eternal earth, or how it ends, or new multiverses appear, but I'm explaining the Christian worldview and contrasting it with the secular naturalist view. So in the Christian worldview, this world, and likely four-dimensional space-time, is destroyed, because believers have been given a spiritual body for existence in the spirit. That means this universe and space-time is temporary, not eternal. Now realize we have just gotten into the confused position of using temporary as a term to define or reference space-time. Temporary being a term which conveys some limit of time, as if time continued beyond the elapse of the temporary time period. But in reality, time will cease to exist as a dimension. Hold on to that thought as I bring another consideration to bear. When you construct or build something, it is often necessary to first have a mold, a form, a jig, or a fixture to assist in the development or creation, the stability and protection of that which will become the final product. In some cases, the mold is reused, but in many cases, the mold is destroyed when production is complete. So if the universe, if space-time is destroyed, if space-time were just a framework within which the plan of God transpired, what is the final product, the outcome of space-time ever having existed? The only things which will survive after space-time no longer exists will be the eternal human spirits which were created and matured while space-time existed. Let's look at the thesis statement again. God created space-time for no other reason than as an incubator for human spirits. For no other reason. I admit that assertion is arguable as well. I'm sure we could imagine and postulate other reasons. But examine any other reason proposed from the perspective of the temporary. Did God need entertainment? If God needed entertainment, won't he again need entertainment after space-time is destroyed? Did God need practice or to learn? What is God learning? If God learns, God grows and changes. If God is learning, there must have been something God did not know. If God required practice, that implies he was not perfect. I find it hard to contrive any reason that explains creation of space-time on a temporary basis other than the one proposed. God created space-time as a temporary incubator for human spirits. And I'll dig deeper into this in the next video. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.